Finally, any effort to resolve maritime differences in the East China Sea and the South China Sea must be anchored on international law, particularly UNCLOS. We must accord due regard to the legitimate interests of all parties and respect legally settled rights. We cannot afford any other future for the South China Sea other than the one envisioned by ASEAN, that of a sea of peace, stability, and prosperity. Unfortunately, this vision remains for now a distant reality. Illegal, coercive, aggressive, and deceptive actions continue to violate our sovereignty, sovereign rights, and jurisdictions. Attempts to apply domestic laws and regulations beyond one's territory and jurisdiction violate international law, exacerbate tensions, and undermine regional peace and security. But despite all this, the Philippines remains committed to the cause of peace upon which our constitutional order is premised. We are committed to addressing and managing difficult issues through dialogue and through diplomacy. The 1982 UNCLOS and the binding 2016 arbitral award provide a solid foundation for the peaceful resolution and management of disputes. Our policy in the South China Sea is built upon these two touchstones. We will continue to work with ASEAN and China towards an effective and substantive code of conduct, one that is firmly moored in UNCLOS. As the world's second largest archipelagic nation, we have more sea than land in our territory. We are among 18 mega-diverse countries in the world, and we have the fourth longest national coastline. We will continue to build upon our significant footprint in enriching UNCLOS, the Convention on Biological Diversity, and the High Seas Treaty. As we work to uphold the rule of law in international affairs, so shall we build our capabilities to protect our interests in our own maritime domain and in the global commons. Under our comprehensive archipelagic defense concept, we shall develop our capacity to project our forces into areas where we must, by constitutional duty and by legal right, protect our interests and preserve our patrimony. And as we build our defense capabilities, so shall we continue to invest in diplomacy. Our commitment to ASEAN centrality shall remain a core element of our foreign policy. At the same time, we shall strengthen our alliance with the United States and our strategic partnerships with Australia, Japan, Vietnam, Brunei, and all the other member states of ASEAN. We will also pursue more robust collaboration with friends, such as the Republic of Korea, India, amongst others. Collaborative endeavors among a few states that share specific interests built into pillars that support the architecture of regional stability. It is in this spirit that we pursue trilateral collaboration with Indonesia and Malaysia in the Celebes Sea. It is the same rationale behind our broader cooperation with Australia, Japan, and the United States in our exclusive economic zone. Last month, the Philippines, Japan, and the United States adopted our joint vision statement on enhancing economic cooperation and contributing to regional peace and security through trilateral cooperation. These partnerships reflect our commitment to preserving, defending, and strengthening the rules-based regional order. And yet the scope, the depth, the breadth of the challenge that our region now faces requires our collective, our inclusive, and our decisive action. Addressing the realities of our regional security landscape requires our greater collective political will. Let us begin by realizing the vision set for us by leaders past. In 1976, five leaders of Southeast Asia, including my father, signed the Treaty of Amity and Cooperation in the Southeast Asia, or the TAC. This landmark treaty is meant to promote perpetual peace, everlasting amity, and cooperation amongst nations. Its goal is to contribute to their strength, the solidarity, and closer relationship. The TAC's provisions were relevant then, and they remain relevant to this day. It is no wonder, then, that the 54 parties from all regions of the world, many of which are represented in this dialogue, have now acceded to this landmark instrument, with nearly a dozen more countries expressing their desire to be bound by the TAC's tenets. This indicates that all stakeholders in the future of this region are committed to peace. It is timely for parties to consider how this treaty can help address the geopolitical and geoeconomic issues facing the region today and the looming challenges ahead. So as we look to the future, let us breathe new life into this noble purpose and the principles of this treaty. Ladies and gentlemen, beyond the regional horizon, we recognize the importance of upholding multilateralism. It remains the single viable platform for collective action against transcendent global challenges. We must therefore step back from the precipice of paralysis. We should transcend geopolitics, find common ground, work to strengthen global institutions. This requires active leadership on the part of middle powers, which have the capacity to cross political and ideological lines, forge genuine consensus, and lead credible efforts towards decisive multilateral solutions. I am proud of the Philippines' efforts to build bridges on issues ranging from climate action to disarmament and non-proliferation, from sustainable development to equitable global health cooperation. In all our multilateral engagements, we seek to bridge global conversations with our unique regional perspectives. Just as Indo-Pacific states must determine our own destiny, so too must we be active participants in charting the future of the world. We must shape the rules. We must build those bridges. It is in this context that we are actively seeking to amplify Indo-Pacific voices in the context of global conversations on the issue of lethal autonomous weapon systems. We likewise seek regional consensus regarding the development of norms of responsible behavior in outer space and in cyberspace. We will bring our experience as a trusted partner, credible pathfinder, and committed peacemaker when elected to the United Nations Security Council for the term of 2027 to 2028. My country has come a long way in our painstaking, often difficult, but steady journey towards the fulfillment of our people's aspirations. Despite daunting challenges and our increasing vulnerabilities, we remain on track to achieve our goal of a high-income economy and a prosperous country by the year 2040, a place where Filipinos live strongly rooted, comfortable, and secure lives. Our strong potentials come with an inevitable rise in our global standing. Just as we have done in the past, we will embrace our role in this region and around the world with a sense of purpose. We are determined to be a force for the good, a force for peace, a champion of regional and global unity, a staunch defender of the rules-based international order. The Indo-Pacific holds much promise. As the fastest growing economic hub and the largest contributor to global growth, that premise must be kept alive. Furthermore, that promise must be fulfilled. Geopolitics must not distract us from our fundamental duty as civil servants, as public intellectuals, as statesmen, to deliver for our people and to safeguard the future of the coming generations. This is the reason why we strive for stability, for security, and for peace. This, ladies and gentlemen, is our core purpose, our collective commitment, our calling. It is for this most noble of causes that we must come together to win the future of our region and to make a better world. And with your help, with our partnerships, with the alliances that we forge, we will make it happen. Thank you and good evening.
That was President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s keynote speech at Asia's top defense summit. The Philippine president stressing the importance of rules-based international order to maintain peace and stability. Marcos also asserting the Philippines' sovereign rights in the West Philippine Sea, saying the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, or UNCLOS, as well as the 2016 Arbitral Award, affirm the country's legal rights in the disputed waters. He maintained he will not yield the Philippines' maritime domain. But he also said the country is committed to addressing issues through dialogue and diplomacy. He added Manila will work with ASEAN and Beijing towards an effective and substantive code of conduct. Meanwhile, Marcos also called on the U.S. and China to manage their rivalry responsibly. This, as he says, their conflict is creating new security dilemmas. President Marcos is expected to fly back to Manila tonight, but several Philippine officials are expected to stay on to attend various sessions of the Shangri-La Dialogue, which will conclude on June 2nd.